Live from the Civic Media World Headquarters in Madison, Wisconsin, it's the Todd Albaugh Show. And now, pursuing truth wherever it may lead, here's your host, Todd Albaugh.
Good morning across the Civic Media Radio Network and streaming worldwide to the Civic Media app. I'm Todd Albaugh. It is Tuesday, May 2nd, 2023. Welcome in for the program. We appreciate you being with us. Mr. Zomers, our producer and engineer on the board this morning. Mr. Zomers, how are you today?
Doing pretty well. Last night, I went to go see Return of the Jedi in theaters with my roommate.
How'd that go?
As I mentioned I might do.
Yeah.
It was fun. It was a good time.
Good time was had by all. Was it, when's the last time until last night? When was the last time you were actually in a theater for a show?
It's been a while. Let's see. The last movie I watched with my family was one we watched at home.
Right.
Because it was Glass Onion.
Oh, yeah.
And that was only in theaters for like one day. So we watched it when it came out on Netflix.
And it'd be quick.
So, yeah.
It's been a while for me, too.
Several months at least.
I mean, streaming has certainly changed that, but also the pandemic, right?
Yeah, for sure.
It's been a while since I've been back in the theater.
I think I know. I think it was Everything Everywhere All at Once.
Oh.
So that was like
How was that? I never saw it.
It was very good. It is a lot, as the name would suggest.
It's everything.
So you have to be ready to take in a lot of stimulation.
All right, very good.
Maybe I should have phrased that differently.
But. Well, it's fine. Well, very good. Glad you saw Return of the Jedi. So you're set. Thursday is May 4th. May the 4th be with you today. Are you feeling the energy, the force around you?
Yes, it binds us together.
Very good. You look a little like with the hair and the beard, you look like a little bit like a young Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Well, thank you.
You put that cloak on and or whatever the robe, and you'd be all set. Maybe we'll buy you a robe and a lightsaber for Thursday,
or maybe. I know I'm pretty sure I still have a couple of toy lightsabers at home.
I'll tell a story. I will tell a story on the air on Thursday about a lightsaber.
I look forward to it. That is very ominous, though.
It just shows my goofy side, which people get to see every day. Weather being a little bit goofy as well for us, as we're still in kind of that, it feels like spring, but a very early spring or late winter mode, particularly for those up north. But hang on, because summer is coming, and it's coming on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. We will be up in the 70s, at least for parts of the state, over the weekend. So we can get through today. Things really start to get better tomorrow. So here's your weather forecast around the state of Wisconsin. First of all, for WRCE in Richland Center, southwest Wisconsin, partly sunny today. Highs around 55 degrees. Going to be gusty, though. Winds are going to be gusty at around 30 miles per hour. So if you have any lawn furniture or things like that, make sure you bring them inside or they're in a safe place, because it's going to be gusty this afternoon. For tonight, partly cloudy. It'll clear off later on, get down to about 35 degrees, and then winds gusting again up to 35 miles per hour or 30 miles per hour overnight. Then for tomorrow, mostly sunny, a high of around 60 degrees, and it's upward and onward from there as far as weather for the rest of the week. Up in Wausau this morning, WXCO Bull Falls Radio, a chance for sprinkles, a high of 44. For tonight, partly cloudy, a low of 31. And tomorrow, mostly sunny, a high of 57 degrees. Winds as well be gusting across the state again, 30, 35 miles per hour. Up near Wausau today. Over in Amory, WLAK, Lake Air Radio, sunny and breezy, a high of 56 degrees. Tonight, mostly clear, a low of 31. And for tomorrow, Wednesday, mostly sunny, 61 for a high, even in Amory tomorrow. And looking ahead, looks like even Amory is going to be in the high 60s for the weekend. So things are going to get better. We hopefully, knock on wood, perhaps we've seen the last snow of the season. That we're going to be getting into the second week of March. We shall see. Coming up on the show, big third hour, by the way. Trying to nail down, I think we're going to have Phil Nee from WRCO in Richland Center. He is going to be coming on, of course, I shouldn't say of course, but in case you haven't heard, singing legend, writer, singer, songwriter, Gordon Lightfoot passed away over the night. And so, of course, he wrote the famous song, The Wreck of the Edmund Fitzgerald, all about Lake Superior and city of Superior, Wisconsin. So I think a lot of us grew up listening to that song. I know I did. And so, in fact, I remember when it first came out. My parents would be like, shh, we're going to listen to this song. It was a super, I mean, a lot of emotion, very cool song, very long song. But Gordon Lightfoot passed away. We'll be talking with Phil Nee in hour number three about that, our music affection hour. Of course, Phil, the host of Those Were the Days every Saturday night on WRCO. And he will talk a little bit of oldies music with us. Gordon Lightfoot in hour number three. And also number three, hour number three at 10:30. Be joined by none other than Luke Mathers, co-host of Dueling Tangents. Can be heard each and every afternoon at 2 o'clock across the Civic Media Radio Network, except in Bull Falls Radio in Wausau, where Chad Holmes has the Chad Holmes Show from 2 until 4. But Luke Mathers stopping by for his weekly visit on a Tuesday. Going to check in with him, see if he's recovered from the Bucks' early exit in the playoff. He looks like he's getting there, moving on. Talk a little bit about Brewers baseball. And also, we'll talk with Luke a little bit today about the Supreme Court. Luke has been all over this story, to his credit, and more news keeps coming out. Luke was one of the first ones to talk about this and the implications it has on our federal government. So we'll bring that up and any other tangent for a Tuesday we could muster with Luke Mathers later on this hour. When we come back, we're going to have some news headlines. The Writers Guild of America is set to go on strike for the first time today in more than 15 years. Your favorite TV shows are in danger of going off the air while the strike is on. Remember this last time we had a writer's strike? Many of the hosts grew beards. David Letterman, that's where his beard came from, and others, while the writers were on strike. Come back with what you need to know, your daily headlines after this. This is the Todd Hallball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. The Todd Hallball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. It is now 15 past the hour of 8 o'clock. That's quarter after 8 on the time and temperature sign. It is the 2nd of May, Tuesday, 2023. Here are your news headlines, what you need to know. Writers' strike. More than 11,000 members of the Writers Guild of America, WGA, are set to go on strike today for the first time in 15 years. A move that might affect your favorite TV shows. Last month, WGA members voted 98% in favor of going on a strike if no new deal is reached with studios over reduced job opportunities and the loss of some sources of income due to an industry shift towards streaming services. The strike comes as many of the companies producing shows that employ the writers have seen their stock prices decline, prompting cost cuts and layoffs. The negotiations are ongoing, but viewers could see an impact with late-night shows, daytime soap operas, and shows such as Saturday Night Live, which could have early ends to their seasons. The strike could also delay the start of new seasons of other shows later this year. Big news for a lot of folks, not just because of the shows that we watch, but a lot of people that you wouldn't think or associate with writing are involved, and they're members of the Writers Guild of America. I'm someone who I constantly say this. I'm a great appreciator, if that's a word, of good writing. And I think it's something that's missed so often, particularly in TV shows, but also movies, other things. Someone who can write well. Actors and have to be able to carry that out in front of the camera or on stage. But if you don't have a good script to start from, if it's not written well, you got nothing. And so my heart goes out to them. And good for them, because reading a little bit yesterday, listening to some programming, a lot of people in Hollywood and New York, and you know, you don't have to be there now with remote work. You could be anywhere and be a writer a lot of times. But I think that there is a lack of respect by some, not all, in the industry for really good writers. And some of these folks, having to live in Hollywood and in Los Angeles, where you know where prices are even higher than they are here in the Midwest, in Madison, Chicago, they're just not getting paid a livable wage. So good on them for holding out. On the downside for us, some of our favorite shows may be on hiatus. We'll talk more about that in a little while. Story two, debt limit. House Speaker Kevin McCarthy has accepted an invitation to meet with President Joe Biden on May 9th about the debt ceiling, setting the stage for a high-stakes moment in the ongoing standoff. Yesterday, Biden invited the top four congressional leaders, including McCarthy, to discuss a plan to make progress on debt ceiling talks. Following months of an impasse between the president and House Republicans, Biden's call came after Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen notified lawmakers yesterday that the U.S. could default on its debt by June 1st. Quote, if Congress fails to increase the debt limit, it would cause severe hardship to American families, harm our global leader position, and raise questions about our ability to defend our national security interests, Yellen said. Biden has not met with McCarthy since February. Russia now. Russia has suffered more than 100,000 casualties since December in its war on Ukraine, according to new estimates figured announced by the White House yesterday by John Kirby. The stunning number, which includes both wounded and killed, is a key signal that Moscow's winter offensive has backfired, Kirby said. The U.S. estimates more than 20,000 Russian troops have been killed in action in recent months. Kirby also said that nearly half of those casualties were fighters with the Russian private company Wagner, following minimal training and leadership. Kirby declined to provide information on Ukrainian casualties, noting that it's Ukraine's decision to make its casualty figures public. Quote, Ukrainians are the victims here. Russia is the aggressor. I don't need to abide by the same sense of courtesy for the Russians, he said. Think about that. Let's forget about the leadership for a second. The people of Russia have endured 100,000 casualties in an absolutely needless war in Vladimir Putin's obsession with power and dominance. Pretty sad story if you are a Russian this morning. Tragedy just south of us in Illinois yesterday. A dust storm. At least six people were killed yesterday when a dust storm in Illinois caused more than 70 vehicles to crash on a major highway. The crashes along I-55 happened in Montgomery and Sangamon counties south of the state capital after dust from newly plowed fields engulfed both north and southbound lanes, police said. Dozens of others were hospitalized with injuries ranging from minor to life-threatening. The cause of the crash is due to extensive winds blowing dirt from farm fields across the highway, leading to zero visibility, according to the Illinois State Patrol. They said in a news release, a meteorologist said 45-mile-per-hour winds picked up the dust and suddenly made it near impossible to see on a short stretch of highway. I've encountered that a couple of times, even in Wisconsin. And I know for a while when I was a kid back in the 70s, 80s, I'm not sure if it was a requirement or not, but a lot of folks along Highway 14, the Spring Green Plain area or Spring Green area, where it's pretty flat, pretty open, and they planted rows of trees along the highway or to separate fields somewhat to stop this very thing. And over the years, a lot of those trees have been taken out, not all, but some, and have not been replaced. Something might want to be thought about here in Wisconsin because, boy, I mean, farmers got to work the field. Can't control what the weather does. But you have something like this comes out of nowhere, dust storm, zero visibility. Thoughts are with those folks in Illinois today. COVID-19. When the U.S. COVID-19 public health emergency expires on May 11th, you will still be able to get coronavirus tests, but they may no longer be free. However, there are ways you can stock up on tests before some costs shift to become out of pocket. Packs of home tests can be found at pharmacies and other local retailers, and costs may be covered up front or reimbursed by insurance plans. The Biden administration's COVID.gov website is also still up and running, which allows U.S. households to order 4 free COVID-19 test kits to be delivered at home. Separately, one of the last remaining COVID-related travel restrictions in the U.S. will be lifted next week. Non-U.S. travelers entering the country will no longer be required to be fully vaccinated against COVID-19 beginning on May 12th. there you go. Little by little, winding down, I guess you'd say, as far as the COVID-19 restrictions. Thought about that. I had to try to get my ears fixed a little bit. I have some ear problems. Went to the doctor yesterday, and my local provider here finally, just this week, lifted the mask requirement to go into the clinic. So it's, you know, good. Good to see things kind of getting back to normal a little bit. It's still out there. People still can get COVID. Still need to get vaccinated, get boosted. But little by little, things are turning around. Here's the silly question for this half hour coming up. We'll have a big discussion, a big debate this morning. What is your favorite cold cereal? I know, heavy news. I saw this and I'm like, well, this would be a great topic to discuss. 715-388-7155. Again, area code 715-388-7155. It's prompted by this. And this does not... I love a good Kit Kat bar. Won't you break me off a piece of that Kit Kat bar? A song, something like that for the commercial. From New York City, who wants a big bowl of chocolatey, crispy deliciousness for breakfast? General Mills is betting a lot of people do, as it is launching Kit Kat cereal nationwide beginning this month at $5.69 for a standard size box. The cereal, whose squares resemble the classic wafer-covered chocolate bar from Hershey's, launched in Europe in March. Why do the Europeans always get stuff first? Like the candy bar, the cereal has a creamy coating and distinct crunch, the company said. The box also shares the look of the candy's distinct red wrapper. It's just one of the many cereals General Mills is launching this spring. There's Cinnamon Toast Crunch Tres Leches. Ooh. Little Tres Leches in the Cinnamon Toast Crunch, available at Walmart and other retailers. And new flavors of Cheerios Vanilla Spice, which sells for $6.88 for a standard box of about 10 ounces and $7.17 for a family size. Cheerios Vanilla Spice.
Cereal has gotten so expensive.
You're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. It has. A limited edition. Oh, here you go, Mr. Zomer. A limited edition Spider-Verse cereal. Red Spider Berry Puffs with blue and white marshmallows will be selling for less expensive, $2.99.
However, it has not been noted whether or not the cereal contains any radioactive spiders.
Right, exactly. General Mills is also launching miniature Lucky Charms and Cocoa Puffs, adding to its miniature Trix, both of which are priced at $5.69. Do we need miniature of everything now?
No.
My youngest niece is very much into small things, miniature things. But she's very talented. She's an artist. But, I mean, we have Lucky Charms. Do we need miniature Lucky Charms? Other companies are innovating their cereals as well. Last September, Kellogg's announced Instabowls, which are little tubs of cereal that contain milk powder. Ugh, I'm not sure about that. They could be either eaten dry or be mixed in with cold water to create instant milk and cereal. I guess if you're camping, I guess being from the dairy state, I'm pretty particular about my milk.
Yeah, and also if you're camping, just bring like a granola bar or bring, right. I don't know, oatmeal. I know.
This move comes as cereal demand softens somewhat from the earlier in the pandemic. See, more, this is the problem. I mean, I'm glad the pandemic is over, but now all these things that people were buying during the pandemic, guess what? The pandemic is winding down, so people aren't buying them as much.
Could have seen this coming?
Exactly. And now the narrative is, you know, from Republicans and stuff, oh, the economy is tanky and look at how things are getting worse. No, it's just that we're adjusting. It's the same way as when we went into the pandemic. A lot of things changed. I have my second coffee shop business, restaurant. You know, we had to do all takeout for a couple of months. I mean, that was a major change. So now things are just adjusting back. So cereal on the decline because of the end of the pandemic. Cereal sales surged to over $9 billion in 2020, $9 billion, or up 9% from 2019 as millennials worked from home, according to data from Nielsen IQ. However, in 2021, sales eased to $8.4 billion, but still above the 2019 sales. Prices for the staple breakfast food have also been rising. Over the full year ending in March, the price for cereal products, you guessed it, Mr. Zomers, rose. Any guesses how much it rose?
20%. I don't know.
13.6%, according to data from the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics. What is your favorite breakfast cereal? 715-388-7155. Take more of your calls when we come back. This is the Todd Allball Show, and this is the Civic Media Radio Network.
Man, ain't nothing like a nice bowl of cornflakes in the morning to smooth you out. Milky cereal,
baby.
Milky cereal, Milky cereal,
baby.
Milky cereal. Mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the baddest female of them all? It was Frosted Flakes. She loved to bowl, and although her skin was white, she had a lot of soul. Rich female, very debonair, driving her Rolls with rollers in her hair. We was hanging out, pumping the stereo. She took me to a club. I think the name was Cheerios. She walked like she was
welcome
up
back
in
a
I was
to the Todd Allball Show. It is now 8:33. That is LL Cool J. Mr. Zomers striking music gold by dialing that one up. What's it called, Mr. Zomers?
Milky cereal.
Milky cereal. And after the weather, we're going to share some of the lyrics. LL Cool J. What was that? I think her name is Cheerio.
Oh, there he was talking about the club. He's saying he thinks the club's name was Cheerios. But the girl was Frosted Flake.
The girl was Frosted Flake. All right, very good. Well, we will. On that note, we're going to turn it over to our own Kara Foster. Kara, do you have a favorite breakfast cereal? We're talking about that this morning.
Well, that's a really good question. I would say my all-time would have to be Cinnamon Toast Crunch, I think.
Ooh.
It is delicious.
Yeah. It is so good. It is so good. But I also haven't had, you know, cereal in so long other than like Cheerios. I always,
really?
You know, now that I'm older, I'm like, too much sugar in the morning.
See, I do it as,
ideally, I
do it as like a comfort food. I'm like, I have like that Jerry Seinfeld thing going. I like to have two or three boxes of cereal. And then like at 9 o'clock at night, oh, I've got like a little bit of a hunger, I have a bowl of cereal.
That's the best time for it.
That is so true. Yes. Midnight snack kind of vibe.
And I try to go between Wheaties and then something sugary. So I'm not always eating the sugar.
Yes. I literally, we were talking about this. My boyfriend's eating cereal on the couch right now.
Really? What is he eating?
Yes.
What is he having?
He loves these, like, I think it's called like wheat squares or something. They sound like they're for, you know, older people. He's only 27.
What, shredded wheat?
They're not shredded wheat. They're kind of a different, they're kind of like
Chex?
A mixture between like an oat square and a shredded, like, I don't know.
But there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, he's eating healthy.
Exactly.
He's a healthy dude.
He's trying his best. Yeah, exactly. He does love Cheerios. That's his number one, though.
Really?
Number one is Cheerios, for sure.
We have a vote for Cheerios. By the end of the week, we're gonna be swimming in Cheerios for weather or something like that. I don't know. Summer is coming. I've looked ahead. I've read ahead to the end of the book, and it appears it's a happy ending in terms of weather.
It really is. You know, we're going to see, you know, constantly improving forecasts, which is amazing. I mean, we've had such a terrible winter. And I mean, even the last like 3-4 weeks have like lingered. I mean, we had the few days in the 80s and even almost had the 90s in there as well. And so then having the winter stuff after that was kind of a bummer. Unfortunately, right now, for some reason, none of the forecasts are loading. I'm trying to give you the
fine.
Information.
No worries.
And they're like, they're not loading whatsoever.
Well, here, let me tell you what the forecast is. I got it in front of me. Rich,
there you go.
Let me audition for weatherology. So here we go. Our forecast for today, sunny skies, high is in the mid-50, probably 55 for Richland Center for tonight. Looks like gusty winds will continue, 30 miles per hour throughout the day, so tie down the wig if you got one on. A low of 35 tonight. Tomorrow, Wednesday, sunny skies, a high of 60. in Richland Center. Looking ahead to the weekend, though, looks like it's going to be beautiful. As a matter of fact, Kara, highs on Saturday and Sunday in the upper mid, highs in the mid to upper 70s in Richland Center.
Yeah.
Up in Wausau.
Beautiful.
Not, still okay, not quite so nice. Today looks like a high of 45 under some cloudy skies. A chance of sprinkles for tonight, partly cloudy, a low of 31. And tomorrow, Wednesday, mostly sunny and a high of 57 degrees. Looks like the weekend, a little wet perhaps up in Wausau, but still a high is near 64 by Saturday and Sunday. And over in Amory, beautiful day, sunny and breezy. Winds are going to be gusty, though. Again, 30 miles per hour, a high of 56 in Amory. Then for tonight, a low of 31. Wednesday in Amory, mostly sunny, a high of 61. Again, rain looks like it's going to move in the northern part of the state for the weekend. Highs will be in the low to mid-60s up in Amory and Wausau. So it looks like the place to be this weekend is down in God's gift to humanity, the Driftless area, my hometown, Richland Center. Sound about right?
You did great. Oh, yes, right, that was awesome. Right. Yeah, I at least knew, you know, the gist of it.
Right,
but
no, of course.
I don't know what was going on with web pages right now. Nothing is loading.
Kara,
so I'm like, okay,
Kara,
well.
I got you because I hate technology. I hate technology. They'll tell you around here. I am an analog guy living in a digital world. Because I print everything, I'm all for the environment, I'm all for being a conservationist, but there's just something about it. Being in broadcasting, I like to read my copy from paper. And so I print out the forecast, I print out my stories, I print, and you know, all these other guys are, you know, 20 years younger than me. They're reading stuff off their iPhones and their computers. But see, this is what happens, right, Kara?
When the
computers go down, guess who's got you covered? The old guy with the paper.
Exactly. Exactly. And we've had so many things. We've had days like this where all of a sudden our entire weatherology server goes down and we are literally, like, we cannot do anything. So, like, if we were able to have it somehow on paper every day, my live call forecast, that would have been amazing. Because, some days it's like this. Or just doesn't load, and it helps out, you know.
But you brought your cereal game. You got your cereal game.
Yes. Yes, of course. You have to. always in the back pocket, you know.
Well, it's fantastic. You know, and I know, in generally speaking, I mean, I don't want to jinx anything, but looking ahead, it looks like the 60s and 70s are going into next week as well. So maybe we've turned the corner. Maybe that was the last snowfall we've had.
I think so. Yeah, it definitely seems more confident. You know, we could see a cooler day like in the 50s, I believe. But yeah. I mean, the one kind of mindset to go from is we're always going to get warmer from here on out, you know, and then we'll obviously, as we head into the fall, we'll get cooler. But then the term colder means something different each week. So right. Colder might mean 50s now rather than last week. It was 40s and the week before that 30s and et cetera and so on. So we're growing, you guys. We're getting out of the rut. We'll eventually be in spring and then summer before you know it.
Isn't it awesome when, you know, in the spring, when we hit 50, 55, we're like, oh, it's warm. This is fantastic. And then in October, when it's 50 and 55, it's like, where's my jacket? It's freezing in here.
Right. Seriously. Yeah. It's amazing how your body just tricks itself into thinking it's two different temperatures. And of course, the sun has a lot to do with it as well. Right now, the sun is so warm. Definitely wear your sunscreen the next few days,
yes,
you guys, because coming from experience the last days that we had those 80 degrees, 2 hours in the sun, I was fried. So,
oh man, yeah, take care of the skin. All right, Kara, thank we appreciate you so very much. Have a wonderful day.
Yes.
We appreciate it. Take care.
Thank you, you too.
Thank you, Kara Foster from Weatherology. Hopefully everything gets set back up for them. I understand. I mean, it happens all the time, Mr. Zombers.
It happens.
Our computers go down, our streaming's off, our commercials. I mean, it's just the world we live in. We are at the behest of the computers.
And now,
go ahead.
Oh, our new systems that our stations are slowly all migrating to are far more reliable, so that'll be nice.
Yes, it will. And see, I'm glad this happened because it drives home Todd's point about computers and now AI technology, and they have their own brain, and now you want to put that in a dog that runs around. I'm telling you, robot dogs are going to be the bane of society. I mean, you thought that picking up after a real dog was a problem. Wait until these things can tear you apart with their metal claws and run 60 miles an hour. We're toast, I tell you. Where Cinnamon Toast Crunch. What is your favorite breakfast cereal this morning? 715-388-7155. Again, area code 715-388-7155. 7155. What is your favorite breakfast cereal? We have text coming in fast and furious. People like this one, I guess. Jeff Perry has checked in. He's going to be in a little bit later in hour number two and talk about the writer's strike as an aficionado of late night television and how that will affect that. But Mr. Perry has checked in. He says his favorite cereal, Captain Crunch Crunch Berries. I didn't know there was a Captain Crunch Crunch Berries.
Yep. They're like red, blue, and green berries in it. Very pigmented.
Oh, that's See, that's a whole other that's a whole other issue, right? When you eat this pigmented cereal and then you use the restroom later and it shows it literally goes right through you. I mean, it's just not polite conversation over breakfast, but it just shows you they pull this stuff in cereal. And I think you brought this up earlier. Sugar, chemicals, all this stuff they spray on it. I mean, that ain't natural. You know, and we're eating it.
Yeah, that's why my favorite cereals, I'll give you some,
all right, yes, give it, yeah,
some insight to as to what I like. I prefer, you know, I do like to have a Cinnamon Toast Crunch or something like that, sure, as a midnight snack. Mm. That's just, it's a good tasty, right, treat every once in a while. Yeah. But if I'm going to eat cereal for breakfast, it's going to be Honey Bunches of Oats or Raisin Bran Crunch. And not regular Raisin Bran Crunch. Because it has the oats and granola in it, and it is so much more filling.
Really?
Normal Raisin Bran, I eat it, and I like get full. There is mass in my stomach because of all the fiber, but I don't feel full or like I've gotten enough nutrients from it.
I get it. No, that's good. I'm not a big raisin guy, so that I would not be a Raisin Bran guy, but interesting. Tom in Florida has texted in. Here's a good one. Homemade granola. He's doing it the right way. He's leaving the chemicals and the sugar behind, making his own granola at
yogurt
home.
And granola. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. This is another tangent, but it is Tuesday tangents. Luke Mathers will be in at 10:30 to talk to us about other tangents. Favorite granola? You have a favorite granola, Mr. Zalmers?
Oh, I don't know, but this is not going to shock you. I do like granola that has raisins in it. Right. And also, if it's got nuts in it that don't kill me, such as peanuts and almonds.
All right, yeah.
More so almonds for granola, I guess.
I'm a big fan of Bare Naked. I also like the granola. Bare Naked Granola. It's a brand. Bare Naked Granola, the Almond Crunch. Almond Vanilla Crunch, I believe it's called. It's very natural. I mean, it has a really nice flavor.
I think I've had that one too.
Bare Naked Almond Granola with like a Chobani yogurt or something like that.
I also have some of my friends coming in with texts.
Oh, really? All right, what do they got?
We've got Jonathan, and he says Raisin Bran Crunch. So my boy Jonathan.
All right, very good.
My friend Avery says Captain Crunch Berries.
All right, another one for Captain Crunch Berries. All right.
And then the other ones are not cold cereals. They're like, or a hot bowl of steel-cut oats. And you're like, yep, I agree with that. That's tasty. And another one, my friend Noah said Grape Nuts Microwaved.
Grape Nuts Microwaved? Wow.
Yep, I don't know.
All right. My little sister has texted in, ever heard of Quisp?
Is that Q-U?
Yes, Q-U, Q-anon U. No, it's Q-U-I-S-P, Quisp.
No, I haven't.
It's kind of a flatter version of, what's the yellow ones that they just puff up?
Kix?
No. They're bigger than that. Oh, I can see the box.
Corn Pops?
Yeah, Corn Pops. They're like a flatter version of Corn Pops. Quisps are, and the marketing was like a Martian or something that had a propeller hat on. We used to have them as kids. She says they were discontinued, but now they're back on the shelf at Woodman's. So I will say, as much as we didn't beat up, but as you're saying, the frustration of shopping at Woodman's, probably the best price for cereal. They have great prices on cereal.
That is true.
Also, Captain Crunch, another vote for Captain Crunch. So, yeah, all kinds of... What is your favorite cold cereal or breakfast cereal? 715-388-7155. Again, area code 715-388-7155. Asking you what your favorite breakfast cereal is this morning. For me, like I said, I'm a fan of Wheaties with just a little bit of sugar on them. And then also the sugar crisps, like the honey bear. They used to be called sugar crisps. Now they're called honey crisps, I think.
Yeah, I believe so.
Yeah, I'm a fan of that. But I can never have just one bowl. I'll have like a bowl, and I always got to have like a half a bowl after that because one bowl just doesn't quite fill me up.
Yeah, so I feel that.
But those are probably my top two. Once in a while, I get a hankering for like an Applejack. Another one I haven't had in years and years and years and years. Fruity Pebbles.
I'm not a fan of the Pebbles because they get soggy.
Oh, they do.
Like
you gotta eat them.
Seconds.
You gotta eat those Fruity Pebbles fast, or it's all over.
Golden Grahams are another one that I like to have every once in a while.
Yeah, a good Golden Graham. Yeah,
there are some cereals that just make me get a stomach ache if I eat too much.
Right.
I don't know why, and that's one of them. So it's definitely like a little treat. You just have one smaller bowl.
Also, I will get it once every few months. I'll get it a Lucky Charms fix. I want me some Lucky Charms. All right, give us a call, 715-388-7155. Your favorite breakfast food, 715-388-7155. Back with more of the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network.
I'm a long way from home. Lord, I miss my loved ones so. In the early morning rain, with no place to go.
Welcome back to the Todd Allball Show. It is now 8:51 on the Civic Media Radio Network on Tuesday, May 2nd, 2023. The incomparable Gordon Lightfoot there, who passed away last night at age 84. Gordon Lightfoot, a music icon, a great songwriter, great performer. Of course, best known in Wisconsin for The Wreck of Edmund Fitzgerald. Phil Nee from WRCO, a host of Those Were the Days, among other things, at RCO, will be in hour number three to talk to us a little bit about the history of the music of Gordon Lightfoot, the song The Wreck of Edmund Fitzgerald. Talk more to Phil in hour number three about Gordon Lightfoot. Great musician. Big fan of his, Mr. Zommers.
Yeah, absolutely.
Also going to be, let's talk a little bit about this song before that, though. The song, the LL Cool J song, because this is a song that A, I did not know existed, and B, now that I do, I love it even more. Because we're talking about cereal. What's your favorite cereal? 715-388-7155. Again, area code 715-388-7155. Happy to have you along this morning and get your information. Also, my sister corrected me. She said, no, Quisp was a take on Captain Crunch. That's what she meant. Not on Sugar Pops, whatever. So it's like a flattened version or I should say a puffier version of Captain Crunch. It's probably the same.
Gotcha.
It's probably the same mix, right? They probably have all the same ingredients. It's just whether they dry them or they fry them or they blow them up.
Certainly could be.
That's just, yeah. And look, my sister sent me a picture of their current cereal shelf. They have a Mickey Mouse Club cereal from Post.
It's the Mickey Mouse Club.
Confetti cake cereal. Confetti cake? Good gravy. I didn't even know they made such a thing.
Yeah, or like Oreo cereal or anything. Yeah. That's too much.
They say, I love a good Kit Kat, but I don't think I want them in my cereal bowl.
I don't want to eat a whole bowl of Kit Kats.
No. Mom has checked in, Miss Linda. She says Cheerios, milk, sugar, a banana, and cherries with yogurt, or milk, melt butter, and add cherries with a little popcorn salt for a snack. Oh, all right. There you go. Mom's healthy snacks.
I've got my friend Elliot says Life is his favorite cereal.
Oh, I haven't. Life. That was the one about Mikey, right? Hey, Mikey, he likes it.
I think.
Life cereal. Oh, my gosh. I'd forgotten about that.
And then Danielle is a fan of Honey Nut Cheerios.
Another great staple, Honey Nut Cheerios.
I'll never turn down a bowl of Honey Nut Cheerios.
Yeah, no, that's really good. See that I like the Life one though. That's what I'd forgotten about. I just you don't see it advertised much anymore. But here you have a Gen Zer who still enjoys a good bowl of Life. 715-388 7155, the number to call if you'd like to join in the conversation about what's your favorite breakfast cereal? 715-388-7155. I'll be prompted this morning by this story about General Mills now launching Kit Kat cereal nationwide. It's going to be $5.69 for a standard size box. It's like, I mean, a Kit Kat cereal. I don't know. We'll see. And to your point, I think it was one of your friends, Mr. Sommers. I also am a big fan, and this is not cold cereal, but I'm also a big fan of the organic oatmeal, the brown sugar and cinnamon instant oatmeal, the organic kind.
It is good. I will say, though, making your own oatmeal, it really doesn't take very long, and I think it's just a lot better.
You're a better man than I. I mean, you're 100% right. You're right. I just get lazy. I'm like, oh, it's in a pack. I just have to open it up a minute and 20 seconds to the microwave, and I'm set.
It's still good, though. Like, it's still,
and there is a difference.
About the
regular versus the organic. I'm not sure if it's a higher cut oat or just the way that it's processed, but the organic, it's smoother. It's creamier when you make it. So just something to think about as well. Also, some people eat their cereal dry.
Sometimes I can definitely see that, especially like Cheerios are a great toddler snack, but they're also just a great anybody snack.
No, that's what mom's saying. Put a little brown sugar, a little butter. She says cherries and popcorn salt. The popcorn salt is a key. You don't think that, but it's finer. It sticks to things better. Big key.
I suppose that's what it's for, yeah.
Right? give us your information or your take on it if you'd like. 715-388-7155. Again, area code 715-388-7155. What is your favorite breakfast cereal? Hour number two, we're going to get a bit serious. I'm thinking about cereal. We're going to get a bit more serious and talk about the debt ceiling. We haven't been a while since we've checked in on the debt ceiling. The clock is ticking. And Republicans and President Biden have to find a compromise here, or we are going to be in a world of hurt come June 1st. So we'll talk about that in hour number two. Hour number three, big hour, we have Phil Nee from WRCO in Richland Center, host of Those Were the Days on Saturday nights. Going to talk to us a little bit about Gordon Lightfoot, his life and times. And also going to check in with our Tuesday Tangents with Luke Mathers, co-host of Dueling Tangents every afternoon at 2 o'clock on the Civic Media Radio Network, with the exception of Wausau, where it is Mr. Chad Holmes and the Chad Holmes Show.
In the meantime, though, let's give a listen to that second verse of Milky Cereal by LL Cool J.
Here's Milky Cereal by LL Cool J.
Yeah, it has three verses, but the second one is by far the best, you will soon hear.
Here we go.
I went to Vegas, didn't think it'd do any harm. I bumped into this girl named Lucky Charm. For some reason, we walked in the rain. She had a four-leaf clover with a big gold chain. She had a salary that was full of calories for real, and I was in the mood for a home-cooked meal. So we went to be alone, but we had to be quiet because the corn pop was home. Kissed the neck, kissed the back, kissed the arms. I said, forget it, let me see your Lucky Charms. When we began, her hairstyle was neat, but when I left the next morning, it looked like shredded wheat. Talked about marriage, I said, that's risky. Besides, it's such a waste of Rice Krispies. She had a robe with a velour material. Her pops woke up, I said, hello, Mr. Cereal. I came this morning to deliver the paper. He said, stop fronting, I know you caught the vapors. That's my daughter, so save the crooning. You better find another bowl of cereal or stick your spoon in.
It's incredible. I love it.
We talked about good writing at the top of the show. I'm not sure that's great writing, but it's creative writing. To write a rap song about trying to hook up with a girl named Lucky Charm and wrap it around the concept of cereal.
We had to be quiet because her corn pops was home. Come on, that's so good.
Because her corn pops were home. That's good. I mean, LL Cool J, he's a dude of diverse talent. You never know when old LL's going to die. What year is that from?
This is from the 1990 album, Mama Said Knock You Out.
1990. We'll ask Phil Nee if he's playing any, what's the name of the song?
Milky Cereal.
We'll ask Phil if he's playing any Milky Cereal on Those Were the Days this weekend. Come back, hour number two. We're going to talk about the debt ceiling, more of your phone calls. This is the Todd Allball Show, and this is the Civic Media Radio Network.